For this episode, I'm working for scale as I learn all about
Sangwasukwai salmon, monkfish. This is a red snapper.
You walk through, same price, everybody. Every store, same price.
The market price. How did they come up with that?
Weed cuisine. More and more chefs are cooking with cannabis, while bakers are eager to sweeten the pot.
Anything from 80 milligrams to 200 milligrams of THC is a good dose for something like a medical treat.
It's not just about getting high, it's about healing ourselves.
So-called ganja-preneurs are changing the definition of what's considered edible.
What we do is responsible consumption through proper dosing.
If there are any leftovers from that dinner party, they'll end up in the organics bin. All food scraps accepted.
Even meat and bones and dairy.
From your plate, to the curb, to the truck, to wherever this is, it all comes out as top quality compost. Meanwhile, it's pure frustration for raccoons and people dressed up like raccoons.
The city's four-legged residents won't stay around.
This week, follow the scent and join us for some fun with New York City food.
There are entire media networks, Instagram accounts, bookstore shelves, corridors of the internet, and lives devoted to food. From Eve with that apple to James and his giant peach, food has always been more than just something to fill our stomachs. Think of your grandmother's sweet potato pie recipe, your aunt's famous latkes, mom's tostones, or anytime some body's uncle steps behind the grill. If the way to someone's heart really is through their stomach, food may very well be the chicken soup for our polarized nation. What would America be without the slice? General Tso's, gyros, guacamole, roti, samosas, and sushi. And that's nowhere near an exhaustive list of all the things we've managed to devour at our dinner tables, even while closing the front doors to the people who make them. 2017's number one cookbook, The Pioneer Woman Cooks, Come and Get It, sold nearly 480,000 copies. Hashtag food porn is connected to 158 million Instagram posts, only dwarfed by the 272 million around the world who simply hashtag food. Yes! Food is a billion-dollar industry because everybody eats. But for a moment, let's think of the growers and the pickers, the truckers and the grocers, line preppers and cooks, the entire universe of individuals who take the time to nourish us. Thank you, and let us humbly offer this next half hour as an amuse-bouche to feed your curiosity with today's special of fish, marijuana, and compost, as we ask, what's that smell?
A tale of two fish. Since 2004, nationally, our consumption of seafood has been on the decline. But in Sunset Park and Greenpoint, two business owners are staking their livelihood on the fruit of the sea.
It's cleaning up.
It's okay. The mess. You can do...
Will Xu's family immigrated from China in 2010, and almost 3 years ago, he opened the Kim Fong Market on 8th Avenue in Sunset Park.
My first Mandarin lesson, crabs 3 for $10.
Sangwasukwai!
One of Brooklyn's most ethnically diverse neighborhoods, and home to one of the largest and fastest growing ethnic Chinese enclaves anywhere outside of Asia.
Yeah.
In the late 1960s, it was a different story. 8th Avenue was known as Little Norway. But as the Norwegians left the neighborhood, 8th Avenue slid into decline. By 1988, 90% of the storefronts in Sunset Park were abandoned. A mix of new arrivals from China and high-rent refuge seekers from Manhattan's Chinatown transformed Little Norway into the Chinatown we know today. And they brought their appetites with them.
So this is a fish head. Salmon, $1.99 a pound. This is a monkfish. Of course, salmon fillets, everyone knows. This is the head of a monkfish. You won't find this at most stores. This is a red snapper. Shrimp, everybody knows.
According to a Nielsen Consumer Report, Asian Americans purchase fresh seafood 50% more frequently than the general market.
It's a lot of supply around the New York City. So you don't have to find them, they find you. You know, when you open a store, they come to your store.
Dexter is Will's crab supplier. He took over the family business started by his mom 4 decades ago. And he knows a thing or two about the fish biz.
$300.
Yeah.
And that's
the highest I've ever
seen. That's gold. So the basic crux of this whole story is trying to find out why I can get 3 for $10 crabs here, but if I go to a different store, they cost easily twice as much.
It costs twice as much. Because, like I said, seafood is it fluctuates.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes there's a lot of crabs.
Yeah.
Sometimes there's not a lot of crabs, but the demand is there.
Simple supply and demand.
Yeah. I mean, I've never seen in my life crabs sell, a bushel sell for $300 in my life, but this year it has reached that high because of the weather.
What are the profit margins like in the crab business?
When you wholesale, it's like $5, $10. You can't do any more than that because, you know, it's a competitive business.
Yeah, 7 or 8 fish stores up and down 8th.
Yeah, 8th Avenue from 39th Street to 65th Street. So if we walk through, same price, everybody. Every store, same price.
Yeah. So maybe competition keeps the prices stable.
That competition extends to the actual selection of fish. While shrimp, canned tuna, and salmon may be the default seafood settings for most Americans, here in Chinatown, they're blowing chicken of the sea out of the water. At Greenpoint Fish and Lobster Co. in Greenpoint, the fish program encourages exploration. While you can always come for the salmon, the chances that you'll leave with something you never tried before are pretty high. Andrew Larson is the fishmonger at Greenpoint Fish and Lobster Co. A transplanted New Englander, fish is in his blood.
So one of the things that always gets me is when I go to a restaurant and there's an MP next to the dish I might want to order, the market price. How do they come up with that?
Yeah, well, the market price is set by the market, literally. So where the restaurant's sourcing its fish from is going to have a unique price every day based on catch, based on the difficulty of acquiring the product.
For various reasons, how fish are caught or farmed, the volume of sales, the rents for retail spaces, prices can be significantly different at the two markets.
It all kind of just travels up the logging line, you know, to your plate.
So how do you price a fish?
Any business, we buy a fish at a specific price, and then we have to figure out the yield if it's like a fillet. So we have experience now and we know, oh, it's 20% or 30%, but you take what you buy the fish from and you take what your yield is, what you get, and you make a little bit of a margin, and it's a simple kind of math formula there. And if that's why it's so important to have good mongers who cut the fish well, because I can't weigh every single fish before it's cut and after it's cut. So if they're not cutting it as well, and they're losing fish and leaving it on the frame, on the bones, and that's 10%, that's my profitability is only 10% at the end of the year.
That's about a pound and a quarter. Cool.
This is an impressive school of fish you got going on.
Yeah, we try to, everyone does the display a little bit differently, but in general, I try to get, you know, it full with 2 to 4 species. If we have a nice big one, I might put a nice big one in the back, but right now we all got just small fish. And yeah, now I'm gonna start working on the shellfish showcase.
Shellfish showcase. Say that fast 3 times.
We have this beautiful program with sustainable seafood. And one of the hardest parts about that is educating people, teaching people about new fish, because everybody comes in and they want to say something that they know and they recognize and is easy. So they say salmon. And if you don't have salmon that day, but you have a fish like porgy, or you have bluefish or something that could be really similar, but is even more sustainable and a better product for them to take, they'll be forced into it. And it's hard in the market. You can't do that. You cut your nose off to spite your face. But in the restaurant, you can put all of those fish into any dish. And if it's an approachable dish, people try it anyways, and then they love it. And you start to get people who want to try new things and come in all the time.
So what if I jump on the G train and 10 stops away from here, I just walk by a place that smells like fish, and they don't have Massachusetts, Florida, North Carolina telling me where the fish is from? Am I being an irresponsible consumer then?
Ask them. And if they can give you an answer and you believe them, then they just do it that way.
Yeah.
You know, there's no right or wrong way necessarily to do it. But as long as people can provide you with these answers, then you're probably in a good place.
So this fish is from a Fulton fish market. And over there, there's lobster, it's winter, summertime. It's all from Boston. It's the season open. And wintertime is all from Canada. I have a shipper over there. They can ship the seafood every week to us.
Louis Zai. Louis Zai. Moment.
Even when you are looking for a bargain, it doesn't have to be at the expense of the planet. Knowing the source of your fish is a way to protect the oceans from overfishing and workers from exploitation.
While politicians continue to bake their position on recreational marijuana, no grass is growing beneath Hawaii Mike Salmon's feet. Under his command as the chef at Chef for Hire, that's H-I-G-H-E-R, cannabis becomes cuisine, way beyond those brownies you tried to make freshman year.
Edibles can be a lot of fun. I think that they can be used for medicinal purposes. I think that cannabis consumption in edibles is this, you know, burgeoning new field, but it's also been going on for thousands of years.
I got started when I was in college. I paid for school out of pocket. I did have a job on the side as well, but in order to pay for tuition, I just ended up having a source for weed, so why not make pastries?
This is really not something new, but the ways in which edibles are being displayed and created, it's this whole new world. And so it's really fascinating to go to legal states and see where these ganja-preneurs are taking medical cannabis. It's not just pot brownies and cookies anymore. It's really gourmet chocolate and candies, and that it's not just about getting high, it's about healing ourselves.
Almond Joy's is pretty much the same process as the peanut butter cups. Pretty much throw everything into your bowl and then you mix it. So if someone wants a custom order or anything that isn't off my basic menu, if you will, first question is it just for you or is it for other people?
The approximate cost of an edible kit is really far reaching. It could be anywhere from $10 to $60. I think it's a matter of quantity and then also quality too.
How much are you willing to spend? That's the second question, because most people don't realize how expensive it is, especially when you increase the dosage. All the normal questions, just also confirming how many people want to get stoned and how stoned you want them to be.
There's these cannabis dinners, and there's people who are offering 9-course gourmet meals.
I wanted to bring people together in a very intimate atmosphere over a shared experience. So we call this the art of social dining. So it's not really just like we're cannabis chefs. We actually don't even like to be called cannabis chefs. We actually just love to cook, to entertain, and to hang out with great people. So this whole experience started by Sunday night dinners with me and my wife, me and friends, inviting a couple people over. That turned into people going, yeah, I could bring somebody else. Then somebody offered us their common area and their building. And then we started doing small dinner parties. So we're doing our kind of play on a surf and turf menu. So we did like a deconstructed salad, a wedge salad with some prosciutto, some walnuts, some pears, some fresh textures, some crunchy textures, some sweet, sour, bitter, all of that. For this one, we infused the buttermilk ranch dressing with a little bit of our extra virgin olive oil. So a lot of the times people look at us and they go, oh, you guys are a cannabis chef and that's all you guys kind of really do. But it's really kind of the opposite. What we do is responsible consumption through proper dosing. It's really kind of reintroducing people to a relationship we believe people had with the plant when it was first put onto this planet.
New York decided to pass the New York Compassionate Care Act. Under the New York Compassionate Care Act, we have no consumption of edibles or flowers at all, which makes it really difficult for some patients to medicate.
Generally, anything from 80 milligrams to 200 milligrams of THC is a good dose for something like a medical treat.
Under legalization, there would be a market for edibles, so you would be able to go into a dispensary and know that you're getting a regulated product. Under legalization, we would probably have stricter consumer testing where the dispensaries or the manufacturers of the edibles themselves would be responsible for accurate dosing and the accuracy of the labeling too with the edibles.
The future of cannabis is actually what we try to present. Like, I look at how we approach things as this is a legal landscape. How would people participate with cannabis if they actually had the choice and could do it however they want? We feel it would be in settings like this. We feel it would be a choice to be social, to be with your friends, to be in intimate places.
Even if you're a member of the Clean Plate Club, there will always be some kind of food waste. A stray bone, some woody stems, a good old eggshell. But food waste ain't garbage, and it has no place in a landfill. Enter the brown bin, where food goes for its second act as brown gold.
The Organics Collection Program is the curbside collection of food scraps, food soil, paper, and yard waste. The Department of Sanitation has this program to get this stuff out of the landfill and actually turn it into compost and clean, renewable energy. You save up your food scraps in a little kitchen container, and you put it inside the brown bin. And each week, Department of Sanitation collects this material and takes it to our composting facilities, which are in the region, and turns it into compost. Yeah, what we call black gold. It's a soil amendment, and you essentially can use this material to feed the soil, which in turn feeds plants and greens the neighborhood, which is why this program is something that we're excited to be rolling out. In front of me, there's these food scraps. Food soil paper, yard waste, you know, if it grows, it goes. So this banana peel, tea bags, orange rinds, apple cores, even meat and bones and dairy are food scraps that can go inside the brown bin. And throughout the week, you know, when you're snacking, you can save it inside of your kitchen container so that you can have it ready to put inside the brown bin. Let me explain how we go from food scraps and turn it into compost, so we'll follow the compost essentially. So the first thing you would do is you put your food scraps inside the kitchen container, this lives indoors, and then you put it inside of the brown bin, which lives outdoors, and you can line it with a plastic liner and keep the lid shut, and then it's collected each week. After the material's collected, if you were to follow your organic truck, a truck would drive its complete route and collect all of the organics bins. Where it would then transfer that material to one of our sites, which is then taken to one of our compost facilities within the region. That's where the leaves, the wood chips, and all of the food scraps together are put into long windrows. One of the differences between old school composting, maybe backyard composting, or composting in the community garden, meats, dairies, cheese, things like that would not be included. But in the organics curbside program, meat, dairy, bones, all of that is fine. And this is because this is industrial composting. The composting process incorporates other materials that would be carbon rich, like wood chips, sawdust, wood shavings, things like that. And then mixed together makes compost. The microorganisms that are in the food waste and in the carbon rich material break down this organic material naturally. After 8 to 12 months, after turning and after time, you have finished compost. A lot of people think of this program, they call it composting. Well, actually, we are collecting food scraps and yard waste to be composted. So compost is the finished material that after this is all broken down, but what we're collecting is, you know, the ingredients to make compost. And we're trying to collect this to keep it out of the landfill. My experience around this, it's really been my life work. You know, I've worked on large-scale composting on farms before I lived in New York City, and I've worked as a compost educator before I worked here at the Department of Sanitation. My goal and belief is to really educate and inform the public and let them know that their food scraps and yard waste aren't a waste, that they're actually a resource. Education and awareness are critical. We educate through community board meetings, through working with community groups and doing street tree care events. We also, you know, have costume characters like the brown bin itself, in addition to a raccoon character, when they sometimes battle it out to show that the raccoon can't get inside this bin. And that's just a way to educate and make the public more aware that this bin is actually rodent resistant.
Got raccoons, rats, or other critters in your neighborhood? Your food scraps are their meals. Using a critter-resistant NYC organics bin means the city's four-legged residents won't stay around, because they can't get a free meal.
This bin has a latching lid, and the lid is hard fast on the bin itself, so pests can't actually get inside of it. The program's evolved in a number of different ways. When we first started, we weren't actually recommending to use a plastic bag. We were trying to capture pristine, clean organics without the use of a bag. But we actually realized that residents really want a vehicle to deposit their organics, similar with their other recyclables like paper and metal, glass, and plastic. They put those in a clear plastic bag. Also, the kitchen containers, you know, people really wanted something that would make collecting in the home simpler, and having something in your home would allow you to collect so you don't have to always go downstairs and put organics into the bin. Sometimes residents put the wrong things inside of the bin. This program's for food scraps, food soil paper, and yard waste. It's not for kitty litter or animal waste or any other waste that is from a mammal. And we don't want diapers or things like that inside of this. It's food scraps, food soil paper, and yard waste. If you have the brown bin in your neighborhood, give the program a try. It's easy. You know, it's just like separating out your regular recycling. And also, you'll be so surprised by how little garbage you're actually putting out. The program also creates a beneficial product, and I don't think that there's anything to, you know, really say about that. When you have finished compost at the end of the day, it's a really great resource, and you should give it a try.
Thanks for going in with us. We'll keep cooking up the shows. And if you want to check out some lovely leftovers, you can always find past episodes at youtube.com/BRICTV. Bye now.